In this video, we're going to quickly define electric potential and potential difference, derive a formula for computing potential differences as a path integral of electric field, and apply this path integral definition to two different examples, one with a parallel plate capacitor and the other with a charged conductive sphere. So to define electric potential, we start with a test charge Q0 near some arbitrary distribution of source charge. The test charge has some electrical potential energy due to its proximity to the source, and we call that U. So the electric potential, that's defined as the potential energy per unit charge. And we give that the symbol V. So we can say that V is U over Q0, where Q0 was the test charge. The units of potential are joules per coulomb. And this gets the special name of volts, or just a V that's not italicized. So one way to describe the electric potential is that it's telling us how many joules of potential energy there would be if we stuck an entire coulomb of charge at that location. So joules per coulomb. So we can turn around the definition of potential and write for a given test charge of Q0. That the potential energy is equal to the charge multiplied by the potential at that location, or Q0 times V. This also means that as a charge moves around, say from point A to point B, the change in potential energy, delta U, is equal to Q0 times the change in potential, delta V. So we can say delta U is equal to Q0 delta V. We could also expand those deltas to write it as UB minus UA is equal to Q0 times the quantity VB minus VA. And delta V gets a special name. That's called the potential difference between the two points A and B. So the main subject of this video is that we want to learn how to calculate potential differences in the case where we already know the electric field around a charge distribution. So we set ourselves up with a given electric field and a charge moving from one point to another within that field. And again, the goal is to find the potential difference as the test charge travels from A to B. And we start with a reminder of the basic definition of potential energy, where we view it as a bookkeeping tool to account for the work done by a conservative force, and that's the electric force in this case. So the work done by the electric force is given by the path integral of the electric force dotted into dl from the starting to finishing positions. And that work is equal to the negative of the change in electric potential energy. And of course, we could also expand that delta and write this as the negative of UB minus UA. Now, if you're rusty on these work energy concepts, I'll post a link up at the top to a quick review of work and potential energy in the context of electric forces. So recalling that the electric force on a test charge is given by the charge times the electric field, we can rewrite the path integral. So we simply replace F with Q0 E, and now we have the integral of Q0 times E dotted into dl is equal to the negative of the change in the potential energy function. Now dividing both sides by Q0, we arrive at the path integral of E dotted into dl is equal to the negative of UB over Q0 minus UA over Q0. But of course, the potential energy divided by the size of the test charge, that's what we just defined as the electric potential. So this simplifies to the negative of the change in the potential, or the negative of the potential difference. So we can write that the potential difference between points A and B is equal to the negative of the path integral of E dotted into dl from A to B. That gives us VB minus VA. But there's a more popular way to write this formula, where we can multiply both sides by -1. That reverses the difference on the left. And we find that VA minus VB is equal to the path integral of E dotted into dl with no minus sign to worry about. Note that we're free to choose a reference point for the potential that we call 0 volts, in the same way we're free to choose a 0 for a potential energy function. The reference point doesn't change the potential difference between the two points, but occasionally we need to be explicit about the reference point when we do an example. As a quick side note, this formula brings up some useful new units for electric field. We see on the left that the units are volts, and on the right we have units of electric field multiplied by units of length in that integral. So we can say that volts are equal to the units of electric field times meters, which then quickly implies a new unit for the electric field. We can write the units of electric field as volts per meter. And this is totally equivalent to the old units of newtons per coulomb that we've used up until this point. So let's apply our new formula now to the simplest electric field, and that's the constant electric field found between the plates of a parallel plate capacitor. And I'll post a link real quick to my main capacitance video if you want to take a deeper look at capacitors. So in the problem, we're told we have two parallel plates separated by a distance of 5 centimeters, and the electric field between the plates has a magnitude of 10,000 volts per meter, and this is a constant. Then we're asked to compute the potential difference between the plates. So in practice, we ordinarily set up the potential difference integral so that we're going from high potential to low potential in the direction of electric field. In other words, for this problem, we're going to perform a path integral from the top plate to the bottom plate in a straight line segment, so the path increments dl are always in the same direction as E at every point. So there's our path from the high potential plate to the low potential plate. And then the direction from A to B is downward, which is the same direction as the electric field. The point of this is that it renders the dot product in the path integral trivial. So now we can write down our path integral for the potential difference. And we get VA minus VB is the integral from A to B of E dotted into DL. And again, we intentionally set up our path so the dot product would be trivial. So because E and DL point in the same direction, E dotted into DL is really just the product of those two magnitudes. And we get the integral from A to B of E times DL. Now we can use the fact that the electric field is constant between two parallel plates. So it can be factored out of the integral. And we get E times the integral from A to B of DL. Now the integral from A to B of the path length increment DL is simply the length of the path. So we find that for a parallel plate capacitor, the potential difference across the plates is just E times D. Now it's common to just set the low potential side of this equal to zero. So this is what I mean by having the flexibility to set our reference point. And then we can just call the high potential side V. So this means we're really using the symbol V for the potential difference because VA minus VB is V minus zero. So I can write down that V is equal to ED in general for a parallel plate capacitor. And now we can go ahead and plug in our numbers. We had an electric field strength of 10,000 volts per meter and a plate separation distance of 5 centimeters, and that has to be changed into meters, so 0.05 meters. And this gives us 500 volts potential difference. So we can say the potential is zero on the negative plate, and the potential is 500 volts on the positive plate. And that 500 volt potential difference generates the desired field strength between the plates. In our next example, we have a charged conducting sphere, and we've put a charge of plus Q on this, and the sphere has a radius of capital R. We're asked to compute the electric potential everywhere, meaning inside the sphere and out. And then we want to plot the potential as a function of R, where R is the distance from the center of the sphere. Now we already know that for a conductor, all the charge resides on the surface. The electric field is zero inside the conductor, and the field around this spherical conductor is the same as that of a point charge at the center. These results all come from Gauss's Law, and I'll post a link to the main Gauss's Law video real quick if you'd like a review. Note that we aren't asked for the potential difference, and this means we get to pick the reference point and then find the potential at each point in space relative to that reference point. In this case, infinity is a good reference point to say the potential is zero there. This is the natural choice because we already know from Gauss's Law that the field outside the sphere is the same as that of a point charge, and we're already in the habit of using a reference point of zero for the potential energy as R goes to infinity. So we'll begin by finding the electric potential outside the sphere at some radius of little r. We set up our path to go from point A, and that's a distance of little r from the center of the sphere, all the way to point B, which is way out there at infinity. Note that we've set up our path radially away from the center of this sphere, and we're going to integrate away from the sphere. The whole point of that is once again to align the electric field with the path length increments, because that makes the dot product in the path integral trivial. So now we're ready to set up our path integral for the potential outside the sphere. And again, that's VA minus VB, but we chose VB to be equal to zero out there at infinity. And this is equal to the integral from our starting point, which I'm going to call little r, to our finishing point, a radius of infinity, of E dotted into DL. So DL points exactly in the direction of increasing R. So we can just swap that out with a DR. And the electric field is the electric field of a point charge. So I can write down Q over 4 pi epsilon 0 times R squared DR. And here's where we run into a little bit of a notational difficulty. We don't want to use little r in two different ways. So one way I'm using it is the lower limit of this integral. The other way is the integration variable itself. Well, the result of an integral doesn't change based on the name of its variable. And the typical thing to do here is to put a prime on the integration variable. So we're going to call that an r prime. And you may have heard someone refer to that before as a dummy variable. The variable inside the integral, it just doesn't matter what its name is. You're going to get the same result. But it's important to not use the same symbol in two different ways. So now we can perform this integral, and we have all these constants that we can pull out in front. We have q over 4 pi epsilon 0, and we're integrating 1 over r prime squared. And the integral of 1 over something squared is negative 1 over that variable. So I end up with a negative 1 over this dummy variable r prime, and then we're evaluating from little r all the way off to infinity. Now, if I sub in the infinity for that upper limit, I get a 1 over infinity, which is 0. Then I subtract what I get by subbing in the lower limit of little r. Replacing r prime with r just gives me an r down there. So because I subtracted that lower limit, the result is positive. And I get q over 4 pi epsilon 0 times r. So there's the potential outside the sphere. I'll go ahead and call that V out. So again, V outside the conductor is q over 4 pi epsilon 0 r, where r is the distance from the center. But what about the potential inside the sphere? Well, E is equal to 0 in there. And that means the electric field can't do any work on a test charge if it's wandering around inside this conductor. In other words, the potential energy of a test charge is constant in there, which means the potential is constant as well. So at the surface of the conductor, we have a potential of q over 4 pi epsilon 0 big R, where R is the radius of the sphere, because that's the distance we are from the center at that point. And then the potential never changes throughout the entire interior of the conductor. So I can say that Vn is q over 4 pi epsilon 0 big R. Again, I want to emphasize that's a constant. So we'll wrap things up with a quick graph of the potential as a function of distance from the center. And I've written the potential function as a piecewise defined function here. We can see the top definition is the interior voltage. So when little r is less than big R, that means we're inside the sphere. And I get this constant number of q over 4 pi epsilon 0 big R. My second function is when I'm outside the sphere. So when little r is bigger than the radius of the sphere, that means we're outside of it. Now it's a variable expression. It drops off like 1 over r. So when we look at the graph of the potential function, we see a horizontal line as little r goes from 0 up to big R. That's that constant interior voltage. But once we hit the point where little r is equal to big R, we start to drop off like 1 over r, like a section of a hyperbola. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.